So let my life be the proof of your love. Let my love look like you and what you made.
John chapter 20. We're going to be finishing up the chapter tonight, starting in verse 24. I know I had you read from verse 19, but we already covered that last week. Today we're going to start in verse 24. And it's belief. Commit to something in faith. But that's a big thing, right? The fear of commitment these days. It's always been there, but it seems to intensify. Why is it that we're afraid to commit? To put our faith in something? Well, we fear that we might lose out, right? If I, by faith, move in this path, I might lose out about not having this other thing because I went this way. So that's one reason why we fear. Sometimes we don't want to commit because we're afraid that we're going to look like fools. If I commit into this and then it doesn't work out, I'm going to look like a fool. So there's another reason why we don't commit. Making a mistake in general, not that we're going to lose out or whatever, but we're afraid that we're going to be making a mistake if we do. So many, many reasons why we don't commit. People don't commit to marriage today because they might make a mistake and somebody prettier or handsome or richer is going to come by. We don't buy that certain car. We don't enter into certain businesses, whatever, because, and then everything might be great, but we're afraid that we're going to make a mistake. So a young man says, no, that girl, no, that girl, no, that girl, no, that other girl. And the girl says, well, maybe, maybe, maybe not, maybe yes, maybe no, and here we go. Fear, fear, fear. And we don't look to God. We don't look to God. Fear determines. But once we've decided to believe, to put our confidence in, then we move forward. And sometimes in the Christian faith, it's about speaking the truth, speaking about the gospel. Because we have decided to believe. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, the Apostle Paul is talking about, hey, believing and therefore speaking. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 13, he says this, but having the same spirit of faith, according to what is written, I believe, therefore I spoke. We also believe, therefore we also speak. Now the question comes, believe in what? Believe in what? What's the object of our faith? Because that's so, so important, right? People believe that certain stones give them healing and direction in life. So they go to California and pick up stones, a certain thing, and they put their faith in that, right? Some of us can laugh about that, but we all have our faith in something or someone. And you know what? There's no way around it, actually. We all put our faith in something or someone, as fearful as we are. But without knowing it, we put our faith in something or someone. It can be ourselves. I'm going to put my faith in me, my own intellect, and my own abilities to figure out things, my own physical abilities, my own abilities to achieve and to create and to build something, and I'm going to provide for myself, and it's about me. I'm going to have confidence in me. Where did you come from? I don't know. Where are you going to die? Where are you going to go when you die? I don't know. But we put our confidence in ourselves, right? So that's one. Some respected uncle or professor or scientist, we find someone that we put our faith in, and there we go, right? The Bible clearly shows us who we are to ultimately place our faith in, our total confidence in, Jesus Christ, right? That's what the Bible shows us. Jesus Christ is the person that we are to put our total, complete confidence in, have faith in him. And in here in John, chapter 20, that's what we find, that Jesus is resurrected from the dead, and we have Thomas doubting, and the resurrection is to produce this faith in Christ, that we can totally, completely commit to him, right? And so in this last paragraph, verse 24 to the end of the chapter, John brings out the fact that he's actually used signs, that is miracles from Jesus, throughout the gospel. The chief miracle, the resurrection, with the resurrection, Jesus challenges believers to grow in their faith and move into their world with the gospel. That's what Jesus did. He showed a number of signs, right? A total of seven. Perfection, right? Seven signs that John, the gospel writer, used to show who Jesus is, the character of Jesus. Who is he? And we're to have faith in him. But the resurrection challenges believers to say, hey, keep growing, and not only grow, but move into your world with the gospel, with the truth of the gospel. That should motivate us, whether it's our spouse, our children, our parents, our siblings, our neighbors, our co-workers, our fellow students, all around us, with a deep, strong faith to move into their world with the gospel, the truth of the gospel. That's what we find in this passage. When we have the person that's called Doubting Thomas, and we're going to see this here. And so with Doubting Thomas, verse 24 to 29, we have see the need for faith in Jesus. And then verse 30 to 31, the purpose statement of the summary of the whole book of John. I mean, normally we don't find this in the Bible where there's a specific purpose statement. Why did Luke write Luke? Well, we have to kind of be careful in research. Why did Matthew write? Well, we have to kind of put it together. But John, the gospel writer, man, he put it right there. Why did he write the gospel of John? It's right there in verse 31. We're going to look at that. So first of all then, the need for faith in Jesus Christ. So here's Thomas. He had been personally in the presence of Jesus when Jesus had committed all the miracles. Thomas was there as a witness of Jesus' all the miracles that he had done. Now, he had appeared to the other 10 disciples. Remember, there were 12. And then we have Judas Iscariot. Of course, he committed suicide. And now there's 11, and Thomas wasn't there, so that leaves 10. Jesus had appeared to the 10 beforehand, but Thomas wasn't there. Thomas wasn't there. So they're telling him in verse 24, but Thomas, one of the 12, called Didymus, he was a twin, by the way, that's why Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. That is in the previous passage. So here we have him. And Thomas would be satisfied by nothing less than material evidence. And that's many of us, right? But his incredulity, the fact that he would not believe unless he saw Jesus, also shows that the death was no fairy tale. Thomas had seen Jesus die. And there's no getting around that from his just reaction. I saw him die, man. You're telling me he's alive? No way. Because I saw him crucified. They buried him. Good way to look at it. But you know, Jesus had appeared to the others. Turn to Luke very briefly. Luke 24, and verse 36 and following. This is very interesting because Jesus had appeared to the other disciples and he basically had told them, hey guys, I know you're having trouble believing that it's me, that I rose again from the dead. But, you know, just so you'll know, come, look at my hands. Stick your hand right there. He told the other disciples. In Luke 24, verse 36, While they were telling these things, he himself stood in the midst of them and said to them, peace be with you. Just like in John, right? These are the, when he appears to the ten. But they were startled and frightened and thought they were seeing a spirit. Oh no, it's Jesus' ghost. Verse 38. And he said to them, why are you troubled and why do doubts arise in your heart? See my hands, my feet, that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you have see that I have. And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While they were still could not believe because of their joy and amazement. You know, you got to realize, man, somebody's raising from the dead. Wow, this is amazing. And their belief wasn't quite there, but they were all amazed in the joy. He said to them, do you have anything to eat? Okay. Tráeme la sopa. Tráeme los tacos. I mean, something to show you that it's me. No, I could go on a lot there because this, he rose again from the dead. This is the resurrected body. And the Bible tells us we're going to have a resurrected body like Jesus. Wow. But we won't go there tonight. But I want you to, I just wanted to show you that Jesus had told the other disciples, hey, come touch my hand. Come. So now go back to the Gospel of John. Go back to the Gospel of John in verse 25. For now, Thomas says, for verse 25, so the other disciples were saying to him, we have seen the Lord. But he said to them, unless I see his hands and imprint of his nails and my finger into the place of the nails, I put my finger into the place and put my hand into his side, I will not believe. Now, we usually say, oh, doubting Thomas. And there were doubts, right? But what did we see in the Gospel of Luke? That Jesus knew the other disciples were also doubting. They thought, man, we're seeing Jesus' ghost. So Jesus tells them, come, touch my finger, look, it's me, right? So maybe, because he was a week later, that Jesus then came again. So all that time, that week, perhaps Thomas was still reeling from the fact that Jesus had died. I mean, all this time, Thomas and all the others had seen Jesus perform miracles. He had confronted the religious leaders. He was fearless. He was their fearless leader. He was Messiah. He is the Son of God. And yet, he died. All his dreams and all were crushed. And so probably he was reeling. I don't even want to get together with the other guys. Man, I mean, this is so confusing. And he wasn't with them when Jesus appeared to the other ten. You see. And so now the others are telling, hey, we saw Jesus. I'm telling you. Nah. Hey, what Jesus told you? To go and look at his hands and all that? Unless I see and unless I put my finger in those holes, I'm not going to believe. Thomas was wanting physical evidence, empirical data, or he would not believe. And many of us are the same way. There's nothing wrong with wanting empirical data, physical evidence, but it's not absolutely necessary. Unless you humble yourselves and trust like a little child, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven, Jesus said, Matthew 18. But here Thomas was, no, I got to have empirical data here. So here we have it. Jesus comes a week later. And he does the same thing as he did with the ten at first. In verse 26, after 8 days, his disciples were again inside, and Thomas with them. Jesus came, the door having been shut, and stood in their midst and said, "Peace be with you." Same thing. The doors were locked, they were inside, and Jesus just, boom, appears in the room. Another thing about the resurrected body, right? First, the resurrected body eats food. The body can go through walls. Second, the resurrected... I don't know how that works. All I know is what the text is showing here, right? It's the resurrected body, and we're going to have resurrected bodies according to the Bible. So here he was, locked doors. He comes in. He's in the middle of them. Now, the other 10 already had experienced that, but Thomas had not. And so Jesus repeats the same thing. Peace be with you. It's going to be okay. And if we ourselves also take hold of those words, peace be with you, it doesn't matter what life throws at us, we can have peace. We can have peace, right? Now, if we're doing what is wrong and we don't have peace, you're not supposed to have peace. If you're doing what is wrong, there should be a guilty conscience. The heart is not right. Your heart should be restless when we're doing what's wrong. But when we're following the Lord and things don't work out, peace be with you. I got this. That's what Jesus was saying, right? So then he goes to Thomas. Hey, Thomas. Hello. verse 27. So he said to Thomas, "Reach here your finger and see my hands, and reach here your hands and put them on my side." Huh, what does that sound like? Does that not sound like exactly what Thomas had said? Point. Thomas, I was right here when you were saying that. I know exactly what's going through your heart, Thomas. Isn't that amazing? We think we can hide from Jesus. We think we can, you know. Nah, he knows exactly what's going on. Thomas, you used your finger, you used your hand, you talked about my side. Well, then come here. I just find that just so awesome of Jesus. Of course, he's God, right? He's God. And so then he tells Thomas something. And something, usually we don't catch this, but he told them, "Do not be unbelieving, but believing." The sense is this. And you don't get it in the English, but the sense is this. Stop the unbelief. You're in the process of doubting and not believing. Stop that. And begin to believe. Be in the state of believing. One of the commentators points out that both unbelief and belief have growth. If you refuse to believe, you're going to keep growing in unbelief. But if you believe, you're going to keep growing in your faith, in believing. And that's exactly what Jesus was telling Thomas. You see, actually, Thomas was very loyal. Thomas, in the Bible, look at John 11. John 11, the Gospel of John right there. John 11. This is when Lazarus had, was sick and was going to die. And they sent for Jesus. And Jesus says, "No, we're going to wait. And he's going to die, but it's for your benefit, for your good." And all the disciples were like, "What?" And so Thomas says, "Okay, you know what? This is all confusing, but let's go with Jesus and let's die with him." Even when things don't make sense, I'm committed, I'm loyal. Wow. We get a different perspective of a doubting Thomas. He was loyal in John 11 and verse 16. Therefore, Thomas, who was called Didymus, there he is again, said to his fellow disciples, let us also go so that we may die with him. Wow. That's pretty loyal, no? That's pretty loyal. You see? So Thomas is, you know, he's a good disciple that we all have doubts. We all have doubts. But Jesus comes and challenges us in our lack of faith. And so he comes to Thomas and says, Thomas, hey, you're not believing. Stop that unbelief. Stop going in that path. Because if you don't believe of who I am, you're going to be going down a path that is going to get darker and darker and darker and darker. And you're going to end up doing things that you never, ever even dreamed that you would be doing. But because you're going down the path of unbelief, you see. Stop that non-believing and begin to believe. Move in that path. And now Jesus says in verse, back in 20 and verse 28, here is the climax, really, of the Gospel of John. Here is the appropriate response. This is what John, the Gospel writer, is wanting his readers to get to. The final response that Thomas had, that's the way we should respond. That's what his readers ought to say. In verse 28, Thomas answered and said to him, my Lord and my God. Both my Lord and my God are signifying deity. That is, you are God. Now, we have to realize that in the Jewish teachings, it was what's called a monotheistic. One God. Mono is one. Theistic is God. The teachings of Judaism was monotheism. So, for a Jew to call a human being God, oh my goodness. You see, the Greco-Roman gods were demigods. They, you know, came back and forth as whatever, you know, animals or human beings or what have you. They had many gods. Polytheist. But the Jews were monotheist. So here for Thomas to say, you are Lord, you are my Theos, my God. Wow. That was pretty awesome. You see, and that's really the climax of the whole Gospel of John. That's what John is saying. That's the way we should respond. After seeing all the miracles that Jesus did, we should bow down and say, man, he's Lord. He is God. And that's one of the hardest things to accept in the Gospel of John. From the very beginning, right? John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And then verse 14 of chapter 1, and the Word, that is God, became flesh. Oops! How are we going to accept that? Man, that's hard. That's right. And for the rest of the Gospel of John, John is showing Jesus is God. And so when quote-unquote doubting Thomas says, my Lord and my God, and I want you to note, the text doesn't say Thomas went on ahead and tested this thing out. He didn't place his finger in Jesus' hand to touch the holes. Oh, no. Woo! My Lord and my God. That's right. Now, obviously the question comes up, well, that was good for Thomas, but that was almost 2,000 years ago. What about me? I haven't seen Jesus. That's right. So now Jesus addresses that because he knew. He knows us human beings left. I mean, he knows us through and through, right? So now he addresses that in verse 29. Jesus said to him, because you have seen me, you have believed. I'm not sure that's a question mark. It could have been, you have believed, Thomas? No, I think he's saying, no, you believed, didn't you? That's great, Thomas. That's great. But you know what? Blessed are they who did not see and yet believe. Wow. Jesus is saying, that is awesome. You had to see and you saw and you believed. That's great, Thomas. But blessed, blessed. This quality and power of life, blessed are those who did not see and yet believe. There's something very affirming, confirming when we have physical, empirical evidence, but something that's much more profound that is there. For instance, we all know, whether we want to admit it or not, that we have sinned against the old holy God. And it's very basic. Our conscience tells us, unless our conscience are seared, are all messed up to the point that we can't feel any guilt of any kind. That is evil, by the way. No wrongdoing. But unless we're dead in our conscience or we're evil, we know, it's so basic, we know that we have sinned against God. And then from there to say that God himself paid for our sins? Yeah, that sounds like love from God. I don't need any physical, empirical data. That's just, right. You see? So Jesus is saying, blessed are those who did not see and yet believe. So now, that was the climax of the, I think, of the whole Gospel of John. But now after the climax, now John summarizes and says, that's the whole point of the book. Thomas's response, that's what it should be. So now he summarizes in verse 30 and 31. He says, therefore, many other signs Jesus also performed in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. Jesus did many other miracles. I want you to know that the ones I outlined, the seven miracles that I pointed out, not all of them, guys, they were just arranged in such a way so I could prove my point. That's all. But there are many, many miracles. And here's another point. Don't get hung up on the miracles. The miracles are not the point. The miracles only point to Jesus. That's all. And we get hung up on miracles and miracles and miracles. And we miss the point of the miracles. That they point to Jesus Christ, the power of God. And so now he confirms that in verse 31. But these things have been written so that, underline that, here's the purpose of the whole Gospel of John. So that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. Three major things in the whole Gospel of John. Signs, all right, miracles. Seven miracles. And what you find when you go back to the Gospel of John? You read, and then he performs a miracle, and then there's reaction. Another miracle, and then there's reaction. Another miracle, and more reaction, right? After every sign, that's what you find in the Gospel of John. And so John is saying, these things I have written so that you may believe. All these signs, so that you may believe, right? That's the whole point, to believe. That what? That Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. Now, Jesus is the Christ, meaning Christos, or anointed one. He is the promised anointed one from the Old Testament. He is the Messiah that was promised to the Jews. He's the one. But it's not just that he's the Messiah. And the Messiah was to bring redemption to the Jews, was to conquer all the enemies of the Jews, was to restore the nation to its glory and more. I mean, that's what Messiah, right? The salvation and redemption of all the Jews. And when the Jews would get all redeemed and so forth, then the rest of the world would say, oh my goodness, look what a great God they have. Well, he is the Christ. But not just that. It says that he's the Christ, the Son of God. Now, the Son of God is not saying that Jesus Christ is the biological Son of God. That's not the point. And that's where people like Jehovah's Witnesses get all messed up. Oh, well, you see, he's a son. How can he be God? The point of being the Son of God is this, that he has the same nature, the same character. Number one. Number two, that there is this intimate relationship between the two. You see? And that's what we have when it says the Son of God. Just to make a point that being son of someone is not necessarily a biological sonship. Turn to the Gospel of John in verse 44. The Gospel of John, chapter 8, and verse 44. Jesus, again, after one of the miracles, was debating with the Jews. And, they were going at it, and they were blaming Jesus for this and that. And Jesus said, man, how come you're not getting this? He was telling the Jews, you're just not getting this. You know why? Verse 44, you are your father. You are of your father, the devil. You mean the devil came and had sex with their parents, with their mother? And now they're the sons of the devil? The devil is their father? And you want to do the desires of your father. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. Whenever he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own nature, for he is a liar and the father of lies. Point. You have the same character, the same nature as the devil. It's not that the devil is your biological father. You see? So when it says that Jesus is the Son of God, it's not that Jesus is the biological Son of God. No, he's got the same nature. In fact, if you go back to John chapter 20 and the last verse, but these things I have written to you, that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you might have life in what? In his name. And what does the name stand for? The character of the person, the nature of the person. And that's where you and I can have life, the real, true life. It is not in sex, drugs, and alcohol, and work, and in money, and in new cars, and new houses. It's not there. It is in the name, in the character of the Lord Jesus Christ. But we must believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. And when we believe, we have life, life, and more life. You see, and when we have life, then we can pass on that life to others. Otherwise, we're empty. We protect ourselves. We become defensive. We become narrow-minded and focused on self, 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 self. Oh, I'm going to be taken advantage of. Oh, I'm going to miss out. Oh, I'm going to
look like a fool. We go on and on and on and on. Because we're not knowing the Lord Jesus Christ, you see. So what's the first application? Because you see, all this again, just showing that the chief of the miracles that Jesus did, rising again from the dead, for heaven's sakes, it challenges us to believe. To believe, to grow in our faith. And not only to grow in our faith, but to move into the hearts of our sons and daughters and spouses and all kinds of people. To move with love into their hearts. And if they reject, they reject, they reject, well, there's nothing we can do. We tell them once, twice, three times, and yeah, you know what? Leave them alone until the Holy Spirit convicts them. But you see, we can move into their lives with love instead of just focusing on self. So here's the deal. First application, stop doubting. Stop going down the path of unbelief. And make a definite decision to trust Jesus for life. You see. Because we all have our doubts in one way or another. We all have our doubts. You see. And we need to stop moving in that path and say, let me believe. Let me trust. And I don't have to have all the physical evidence like Thomas. No. I know within my heart, man. That I need the love of God. I need the wisdom of God. I need him. It's so basic. And to trust, stop doubting and begin to believe more and more and more. Make a definite decision. Lord, I'm going to stop doubting, Lord. And I'm going to start believing. I need your grace to help me, Lord. Because I can make this commitment, but if you don't help me, I'm dead in the water. So stop going down the path of unbelief and make a definite decision to trust in Jesus Christ for life. Application number two. I start off with a question. On what are you believing in? Where's your faith? Where are you placing it on? You might say, well, Jesus, of course, really? What does your life actually show? Are you moving with love and power and confidence and a peace that is there that even when things don't go the way you want them to go, there is a steadiness because you know God is with you. And you don't have to be all defensive. But if you are defensive with your spouse, with your children, with your parents or whatever, what does that show? You're not really trusting the Lord. So you need to ask the question, well, what am I trusting in? Here's another way to put it. What's your ultimate authority for your life? The choices are many, right? Tradition. 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 Why do you do the things you do? Well, my grandma did it that way. And my mom did it that way. I have to do it that way. Tradition, right? That's the way we've always done it. And that can go very deep. You know? This is the way my dad dealt with my mom, so that's the way I'm going to deal with my wife. Was it right? No, but that's all I know. Tradition. It can be social tradition, it can be family tradition, it can be even religious tradition. But if it's not of the Bible, if it's not of the Word of God, if it's not of the Lord, wait a minute, that ultimate trust needs to go. It needs to be put in the Word of God, in the Lord Jesus Christ. How about science? Our young people are being sucked into it by our technologies and our scientific endeavors, and they are many and they are very, very good. It's not that science is bad, but science is being used to replace God. The latest discoveries or favorite professor or theory. And we start putting their faith in that. Others may be certain individuals, friends or older people or parents or some priest or professor or something that we put all our ultimate faith in. It shouldn't be. It should be the Lord Jesus Christ. As I said, it could be our own observations and logical intelligence and the ability to rationalize and put two and two together and figure out life. No, no. Now, that doesn't mean that we put aside our intelligence and we put aside our logic. No, God has given us reasoning power and common sense. We don't throw that out the window. No, we stay our eyes wide open to what God has shown us. But ultimately, we trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ rose again from the dead, just like he said he would. And he did it. And so, we need to question. That's the second application. What am I trusting in? Who am I trusting in? If I say Jesus, then it should show in my life. But whatever shows in my life shows, reveals who and what I'm really trusting in. So examine. That's the second application. First was stop doubting. Stop being in unbelief and make a decision to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Number two, examine. Examine who or what are you really ultimately believing in, trusting in. Then finally, the last application is this. We are to move into our world with the power of the resurrection. We are to move into our world with the power of the resurrection by moving into the world just like Jesus did as he obeyed the Father. Right? Just like he obeyed the Father, so he was able to move and say, hey, I trusted my Father now. When I trusted my Father, what did he give me? Careful. What did trusting my Father give me? Scars in my hand. Scars in my side. It was a life of sacrifice. That's right. As I believed my Father. But you know what? I conquered death. And you and I, as we move into our worlds, we're going to experience rejection. We're going to experience being misunderstood. We're going to be rejected at times, and it will hurt. But be at peace. I have overcome the world, Jesus said. And we will be able to show others our own scars. And say, I'm alive, baby. There's nothing you can do to scare me. Because Jesus conquered death. And I am here to tell you that no matter what happens, there's life in Jesus Christ. We can move into our world. That doesn't mean people are going to accept. They may not. And the probability is that they won't. But you will experience the power of the resurrection. Will you? Will you? It's a choice we all make. And sometimes that choice, listen, sometimes that choice brings loneliness for a season. For a season until we learn how to trust Jesus at a depth we have never trusted him before. We're going to be very alone and yet not alone because Jesus is with us. Jesus is with us. But we will feel the loneliness, you see. But as we keep trusting and keep trusting and keep trusting, we will know him at a personal level like Jesus knew the Father, you see, and he was able to conquer death. But we must trust him as we move into our world in faith. Faith at what? That Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, God himself, and he is with us. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe, Jesus said. We must trust him.
So let my life be the proof of your